come on in. Do they have stricter restrictions there than they do in the US, or is it starting
to? Yeah, weirdly, there's like not a big, mask wearing isn't really big, but right now the doors aren't open and we're not going to school. I think they're regulating it a little more specifically.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense.
Congratulations on your book.
Thank you. I noticed that our author photos were like the same, our hair like this, and then our
earrings
tangling here.
That's why I paired you guys together. Yeah. Makes sense now.
We look good side by side.
I had my friends like stage that photo shoot in their backyard. It was like, these earrings will go this way, your hair will go here.
Yeah, same. I took mine in a graveyard, actually.
Oh, spooky.
Yeah.
How's the week been so far?
The week?
Your book
book.
Yeah.
I forgot because I'm in another country and it's just so... I'm so disconnected from it. So yes, it's been good. Yeah, I almost forgot that it just happened.
My book came out in August and it sort of felt like it never happened. Like I'm still waiting for like the event that will make it feel real, but there's no events coming.
Yeah, I know. Could you do anything for it?
Just like Zoom stuff.
Yeah.
And my roommates made like a banner out of, or maybe my boyfriend just meant, someone made the banner with like an orangutan on it. So that was
great. Do you ever get a chance to like relaunch it? Is there like a redo kind of things considered?
There's the paperback, mm-hmm. which I'm hoping that's in August, and I'm hoping to go back to Kansas in September, and that will maybe feel like a thing.
Right. Very good.
Okay. You're gonna, it's
nice. Yeah, we might want to, I guess we'll start here. I was waiting to see who all was going to sneak in at the last minute, and but I'm glad to see everybody's here. You guys can't see each other, but we can see who is here, and I understand that people have to come and go, so don't hesitate if that's the case. Okay, but I just want to welcome everybody to our second week of the online literary series Celebration of Literary Arts, sponsored by Des Moines Area Community College. And I just wanted to give you a little heads up about our schedule. I'm going to put it into the chat here, and just to know that, you know, we have 8 more weeks. And we're still booking people and we're still confirming some dates. But if you go to our website, you can look at the writers who we have coming every week, and you have an opportunity to register for those readings ahead of time. And every week we'll have a video of the reading that you just were at. So it'll always be updated with the past and the future. But today we have two fiction writers joining us, Becky Mandelbaum and Maria Adelmann, who are going to read from their work. What we'll probably be doing is we'll start off with an introduction. We'll have a small conversation about their newest books. And then they'll each take a turn reading to us for about 10 or 15 minutes from their work. And we'll end then with a Q&A. So that is where you guys come in. And if you notice in front of you on Zoom, you have a few tools in front of you. We'll have an ongoing chat that's going to be active. And so I wanted to encourage people to put things into the chat. It's the one good thing that happens at a Zoom reading that you don't get at a face-to-face, is that we can have kind of an ongoing dialogue where people often kind of confirm or applaud or offer some lines that they enjoyed, or, you know, somehow reinforcing some of the things that they're hearing in the reading. But maybe more importantly, we is to have a Q&A chat box, and that's where you'll place your question for the Q&A. So throughout the hour, go ahead and just drop something in there. Nobody can see it, and you can even make it anonymous to me. So there's no risk in terms of, you know, or in case you're Zoom shy, there's no need to be. You can just drop it in there, and hopefully we'll have time, last 10 or 15 minutes, to answer at least three or four, if not more, than of your questions. Right? But first, let me introduce our two readers, and then we will open it up to them to have a small conversation. So today, we have Becky Mandelbaum, who is the author of The Bright Side Sanctuary for Animals and the short story collection Bad Kansas, which received the 2016 Flannery O'Connor Award for Short Fiction, the 2018 High Plains Book Award for the first book, and was a Kansas Notable Book in 2018. Her work has appeared in One Story, The Sun, Missouri Review, Georgia Review, Alaska Quarterly Review, The Rumpus, Prairie Schooner, and has been featured on Medium. She has received fellowships from Writers by Writing, Writing by Writers, a residency from the Helene Wurlitzer Foundation, and a finalist for the 2019 Disquiet Literary Prize in Fiction and the 2020 Nelson Algren Award. Originally from Kansas, she currently lives in Bellingham, Washington. And she will be joined by Maria Adelmann, whose work has been published in Tin House, the Threepenny Review, Indiana Review, McSweeney's, Alaska Quarterly Review, and she has an MFA in fiction from the University of Virginia. I'm just reading your bio from your website real quick. But most importantly, she has a new book out that you might have heard us talking about that just came out last Tuesday called Girls of a Certain Age, another short story collection. Let me maybe open it up to both you guys. And Becky, although you have a new novel out, you originally had a collection of short stories. I should probably show your books. So we have Maria's book right there, and then we have Bad Kansas from Becky. And I was curious about how you guys conceptualized your books when you're putting them together, and in particular, like a short story collection. What were some of the kind of organizing principles, I guess, that you were thinking about? Becky, do you want to start us off?
Sure. This might be an unsatisfying answer because I didn't really know I was making the book when I was writing the stories, but most of them I wrote. I grew up in Kansas, and then the first time I left as an adult was to go to grad school in California, where I wrote most of the stories in Bad Kansas. And I was just so homesick while I was in grad school that they all sort of focused around Kansas, and a lot of them feature people from Kansas who I, you know, the characters in there are people that I was missing at the time. So it just sort of naturally evolved out of what I was feeling at that point in my life. And then when grad school was over, I had my thesis and they were all about Kansas. So I just sort of stuck them together. And that's sort of how it came to be.
Did you ever, when you were living in Kansas, did you write about Kansas, or was it only when you really left Kansas that you could kind of look back at that landscape and see it in a new way? That I just know many of our students that I teach, we live in Iowa, and so they don't want to write about Iowa because they think Iowa is like the boring place. But when they get outside of Iowa, they kind of see how specific it is. And I was curious if you had a similar experience.
Yeah, it completely that, you know, it's like the water that you swim in, you don't notice it. And I remember I wrote, The Bright Side is actually a novel that I started while I was an undergrad at KU. And it was originally set in like Austin, Texas, and then a really rural town outside of Austin. And when I went back to it years later, I was like, why the fuck did I have this in Texas? Like I lived in Texas for a couple of years when I was a really little kid, but otherwise like there was no reason to set it there. And I think it is this idea that it's more exotic or fun to set things in other places. And I think I had the notion even as a college student that like nobody would care about Kansas if I wrote about it. But the reverse is true, is that I cared more about the story when it was set in Kansas. And I think that, you know, that care is what makes fiction come alive. So
yeah, so you write fiction, some people are like, oh, I get to escape myself. But really, like, you're trying to like put a mirror up in front of yourself. And for some reason, we avoid it. But you finally came to terms with your heritage, I guess, right? And so Becky was mentioning her newest novel, The Bright Side Sanctuary for Animals. And if you haven't picked it up, you should. We're going to talk about this a little bit later when it comes to novel writing. But Maria, what were you thinking about as you were putting your book together?
It's funny, my answer is somewhat similar to Becky's, in which I didn't really know I was writing a collection. I wrote some of these stories, you know, in college and then in grad school and then after grad school. So it was a really long string. And when I thought about putting a collection together, I just opened up my folder of stories. And it was just really obvious to me which ones fit together. So I think I kind of organically knew which stories were on theme. And of course, you know, on the surface, it's obvious when you read them that they're all female narrators, either first or second person. But I think more than that, there's a particular tone, and there's this sort of sense of loss in all of the stories. So I think these were all kind of themes that I saw when I looked at the stories and knew which ones I wanted to include.
Right. So what would you say is like the overarching tone? I like that idea of like a tonal kind of like through line in a collection.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I think it's dark humor. You know, there's some cynicism in there. I think they're exploring similar questions, a lot of the different characters. I think they I just knew they would work together.
Absolutely. And a lot of them are young women, kind of a coming of age stories. And you're kind of reinventing those a little bit in new ways. But one more question before we, you know, start reading. Becky, obviously you have a novel that came out a few months ago, and Maria, I think you have a novel that's forthcoming within a few months, I believe. Is that?
Well, my finished copy is due to the editor in a few months. I think it'll come out next year.
Okay. But it's complete, and so you have like a novel kind of in the works. And so I'm just curious about how we have many students who want to be novelists, but they're being made to write short stories. And so they're trying to figure out like what's the different processes between the two. And we have these conversations often. Very curious about how you guys approach it differently. And not just in terms of the process, but in terms of like how you know you're writing a novel as opposed to a short story. At a certain point. Maria, you want to maybe start the conversation there?
Yeah. Well, my favorite quote about the short story versus the novel is Julio Cortazar. He says, a short story must win by a knockout, but a novel can win by points. And it's, you know, a boxing metaphor. And I think it's a good one because there kind of needs to be a punch in a short story. In a novel, you can sort of work by accumulation. And I mean, I find the novel challenging because I spend a lot of time in the unknown, not knowing if it will work, if I could finish it. Whereas a short story, you could sort of be finished with at some point, even if it's throwing it in the trash, but there is like, it does feel like you don't lose quite as much when you put your time into it. I also read recently that a novel is like telling a joke and then waiting 2 years to find out if anyone thinks it's funny. So I do find it more stressful, but of course, when I was writing the stories, there wasn't really any pressure on it. I didn't know they would be published. So it's just a really different experience for me personally.
Yeah. Becky, do you want to add on to that?
I love both of those metaphors a lot. Yeah, the novel feels, it's just way higher stakes because for me, the thing about a short story that's so comforting is you can sort of hold it all in your head at one time. Whereas the novel, it's like, it's just too big. And I feel like I can't see the whole thing at once. And it, you know, like if you make a mistake or what you think is a mistake in chapter three, like that mistake will ripple through the whole thing. Whereas in a story, like, you know, a mistake early on, you might have to finagle the next 10, 15 pages. But a novel, it's like, you know, you can make a 200 page mistake, and that is really painful. And like in the bright side, you know, I added a dog pretty late in revision, and the dog was really important. And like, I had to go in and insert the dog in like every scene for 300 pages. And so just, I think just the scope of it and the stakes are so much higher. And like Maria was saying, there's so much more time to be nervous and anxious, because like you're just alone with it for so long and you're waiting for feedback. Whereas a story, you can, you know, you can send a draft out pretty quickly if you're fast enough. But
so when you retroactively insert a character, dog, or any element, I guess, you have to still make it feel like it's an organic addition, and not like the reader being like, oh, that doesn't feel like it. They'll sense probably if it was, you know, dropped in at the last minute. So what was some of the strategies you had? I mean, I think that would be tough to retroactively like rewrite a character into a book that's already done.
This book, I think about it, and I read it so many times, and that was the only way I could really achieve anything in revision, like inserting a dog on revision number like 7 or whatever, is I just had to read through it from beginning to end so many times. And I need to go plant like 4 trees, because I like to revise on paper. So it was a lot of like printing the book over and over again, and just making sure like that the dog tracked all the way through, or that like, oh, this character is actually a little more selfish than she's been in some of these other scenes, so I need to like add her selfishness in. Or novels are a beast.
Well, one last question about novels, then I want to hear obviously from both of you. You were thinking about you know, you 2 years before somebody will read it or critique it or whatever. Now I'm thinking about you as a writer. When you're in that process, do you know where the novel's going to end when you're writing it? It's so big. Or are you kind of like flying by the seat of your pants, which you can maybe do more in a short story? I guess I'm thinking about planning. How far ahead do you start like outlining things? Becky, did you do some of that?
I feel like I have something I'm writing towards, like a scene that I think would be interesting, or like something good or something bad that I want to happen to a character. And so I'll write towards that. And then once I get to that stepping stone, I'll like envision the next stepping stone. But I never have, you know, I don't do the full outline like some writers do. And I don't ever really know what's more than maybe 20 pages ahead, which would probably be really comforting.
Yeah.
I saw this tweet one time recently where someone was like, one time a lawyer friend of mine told me that if she ever wanted to write a novel, she would just write an outline of every chapter and then write those chapters. And I was like, oh my God, that sounds so simple to just be like, oh, I'll figure out what I want to do and then I'll do it. But like, that's not
all the time. Yeah, it's not the law. It's not a contract that you're creating.
Yeah.
Nonsense. Maria, how about you? Do you kind of see 20 pages ahead, or do you have a finish line in mind?
I often do have a finish line in mind, but then it turns out that I'm not running towards that line at all. I'm running towards a completely different thing. And I would never want to like in detail outline the whole story, because I think there's something organic that happens as you write, where the characters take on a life as their own or interact with each other in a certain way. And I like the sort of energy of the story finding you a little bit. There's something in that. So I don't think I would even do a good job if I made a detailed outline. I'm sure I would just abandon it immediately.
Right on. Very cool. Well, we'd love to hear from you guys. So who would like to start off? Maybe we'll start off with Maria. Would you like to read a portion of your work to us?
Sure.
Absolutely.
I'm going to read from a story called Unattached. So here it goes. I was out for a run, neck to ankle in pink and black spandex, and for a single happy moment, I felt sleek as a scuba diver. Running was a new hobby. I like to play Mandela. When things end poorly, I write lists of lessons I've learned, changes to make, etc. Incidentally, I have a lot of lists, mini spiral steno pads full of them stacked under the bed. After Dylan left, I'd resolved to run daily. I'd gotten the idea from Googling something stupid, something like relationship failure not connecting. The goal was to feel every part of myself as the human animal it's supposed to be, as muscles and lungs, as feet on pavement, grounded, because I was having that problem again, connecting. And it was working, maybe, sometimes. In small spurts of letting go, the hot burn in my lungs would feel like fuel instead of fire, and I'd be off, springing down the stone gray sidewalk, pretending the scenery was blurring by, a Monet of lime green and yellow grass and brown brick townhouses. And then it would be over, and I'd be tired again, my chest heaving, and I'd begin to worry about the things that can befall a person while running, while being outdoors, while being a woman, rape, murder, relentless ridicule that cuts to the bone. What did befall me, in the end, was none of these things. That day, the sky was awesome, like some high saturation desktop background, bright and empty, save for a single cartoonish cloud. An exhilarating tingle hung in the air, like the shift in energy before a storm, negative ions, Dylan always said. I was making a list in my head that had nothing to do with self-improvement, milk, eggs, tuna, peanut butter, when the hairs on my arms stood straight up. My stomach dropped, that belly flip feeling like when your car takes the crests of a hill at just the right speed. As I tried to run, I realized my feet weren't on the ground. I was floating, or was it falling, towards a tree whose branches had been, just moments before, directly and safely above my head. By some instinct I'm glad to know I have, I grabbed onto a branch while the rest of my body headed onward towards the sky in a sort of slow-mo somersault. Well, shit, I thought. There are a lot of things you imagine you'll do in a crisis, but there isn't much you can do while hanging from a tree, legs shooting sneaker first into a pit of blue sky, looped shoelaces dangling in the direction of the sun. I felt like a piece of postmodern art, Photoshopped somehow into this predicament. In theory, I was upside down, but no blood rushed to my head. I felt light and buoyant. It was as if gravity had not only reversed, but also weakened. I inched my hands along the branch, recalibrating my movements to contend with the extra float, and wrapped myself tight around the tree like a cartoon bear. My head was pointing toward the grass of someone's lawn. Around me, everything that had been unattached was either going or gone, ascending toward the heavens like escaped helium balloons drifting casually away from the earth. Ants and acorns, leaves and dirt, flowers and terracotta pots and lawn gnomes and lawn mowers and children's toys, like a dirty blue and yellow plastic slide, the kind I remember playing on as a kid. A wiffle ball clinked out of a gutter. A black hose rose like a charmed snake up the length of the house and hovered there. Cars that had been parked along the sidewalk or in driveways moments earlier were already hitting the stratosphere. One disappeared into that flat, fat cloud near the sun. I heard a whimper. Was it me? But no, in the distance, I caught sight of a family dog spinning through the sky. I felt nauseous because my brain kept flipping the picture, reinterpreting which way was up. When I saw the world as upside down, then the houses and trees were like stalactites hanging from the ceiling of earth above my head. And our little civilization was very small, just the tiniest inhabited layer in a world made up almost entirely of air. Soon the sky cleared, save the occasional flower that suddenly popped out of the dirt and drifted away, or a leaf like the orange-brown one that detached from a branch just a foot from my head. I fought the urge to reach out and grab it. Instead, I watched it fall away, kept watching it, straining my eyes until I lost it to the grain of vision. I listened for the dog, but it too had disappeared. By now, I'd shimmied down to sit on a branch, though I didn't dare let go of the trunk. The air smelled of overturned earth, a golden mid-afternoon light, the kind only possible in late fall, shone through the brown and red leaves in my tree, making them look like the final standing shards of a stained glass window. A serene dreaminess overwhelmed me, the sort of peace I imagined people felt they had when they'd conceded to death. I thought about calling for help, but it didn't seem appropriate. After all, I wasn't the only one in a predicament. Besides, I'm not an inspired yellow. It's one of my flaws, really, and the reason I quit karate in fourth grade after only getting a yellow belt. It was the reason I only whispered whoopsie one summer day when I fell sideways while wearing a wedge sandal and sprained my ankle, walking on the foot for a week before seeing a doctor, and why I felt embarrassed when my mom screamed in the middle of a Walgreens after learning her sister had gotten hit by a delivery truck while trying to cross the street in Midtown, and why I didn't cry at the funeral or any of the days before or after, and why my own sister whispered in the middle of an echoing church, "What the fuck is wrong with you?" It's strange how calm I am in a crisis, because I'm afraid of everything. I'm afraid of people, waiters, tech support, pizza delivery guys, coworkers, even the people I'm supposed to know. I'm also afraid of transportation, planes, subways, trains, buses, cars, elevators, also invisible things, carbon monoxide, those brain-eating amoebas found in lakes. I'm far-seeing, a chess player calculating all of fate's possible moves. Expect the unexpected is my motto, but even in the many detailed and wild scenarios my brain had conjured, I had never expected this. The breakup with Dylan, that I expected. I braced myself for it from the moment we met, and even so, I let him nestle in like a worm inching its way into the heart of a rotting apple. Symbiosis began to occur. He bought me half-price lunch from Bubba's on Wednesday afternoons, a giant burger, well done, plus two surprise sides of his choosing. He cleaned off my perpetually fingerprinted glasses with a magic combination of his warm breath and whichever cotton t-shirt he was wearing. He was a member of a community wood shop, and he kept asking me what I wanted him to make. I don't know, I kept answering, whatever you want. Dylan claimed my rising intonation was a defense against commitment. I don't think so, I said. Maybe I just talk like this. Maybe our whole generation just talks like this. What was I supposed to tell him? That he was right? That I actually liked my IKEA furniture? That I took comfort in its smooth laminate look and the pleasant feeling it gave me, a longing for some made-up version of Scandinavia? That one day we would break up and I wouldn't want furniture that would remind me of him? In the end, he made me a corner shelf for my most impossible corner and a media cabinet that perfectly held my TV and peripherals. Just as I feared, they were so flawlessly tailored to my life that I could never get rid of them. In the night, Dylan looked like the outline of a person I might not know. "You asleep?" he'd ask when he was almost out. "Definitely," I'd answer. He'd kiss me and I'd forget to kiss back. "Where are you?" he would ask. I was in one of a million places. I was the ghostly figure in the gray dust aftermath of a subway bombing. I was the eviscerated human hanging from a shattered passenger side window. I was a bodega shopper shot and losing blood next to a display of Cheetos. "Where am I supposed to be?" I would think, but I'd say, "Nowhere." I wrote this on the list of things I'd learn. The answer is here. That's always where you're supposed to be. The temperature was dropping, or maybe it was just cold because I wasn't running anymore. I tried to stop thinking about Dylan. I tried to just be mindful, a skill I was learning from a meditation podcast, or was trying to learn between advertisements for box subscriptions where you get overpriced samples of snacks and clothes delivered directly to your door. I was supposed to think about what my body parts were feeling, but this usually led me into a panic because I'd focused a lot on my teeth, which were always on the brink of decay. This time though, I skipped the teeth entirely and went right to my hands, which were holding onto the tree so tightly that they were starting to ache. I gave each a rest in turn, shaking one hand out and then the other. The bark had left an imprint on my skin that I watched fade as I bent my fingers back and forth. A voice suddenly calling out to me, "Excuse me, hello?" I flung my head toward the townhouse. Whoever was yelling, I was in their lawn. It was a woman with a white fluff of hair. She stood in the open doorway, two stories of house and a pointed roof and a blue sky pitched below her. Behind her, papers were scattered on her ceiling, which was now the floor, and a wooden table was legs up like a dead bug. A bald man bounced into view like an astronaut on the moon. He seemed to be enjoying himself. "Mass and distance," I heard him shouting, "mass and distance." "Are you okay?" the woman called. I envied that she was able to sound concerned while yelling. Sometimes I had difficulty establishing appropriate volume and tone during conversations, especially with people I didn't know. Just be yourself, Dylan had recommended. But what if I was already just being myself? Just be yourself, I'd written on the list. Then I'd scribbled out the question mark. Later, when reviewing the list, I put it back in. Fine, thanks, I croaked back to the woman, too quietly, then louder and too aggressively. Yes, thanks. Would you like to come in, the woman called. I made an awkward little laughing noise because this seemed impossible because I was sitting in a tree about 20 feet from this woman's front door. I opened my mouth and closed it again, trying and failing to think of an appropriate response. Hold on, she shouted, and then she closed the door and disappeared. I waited in the tree, trying to be mindful about my body, except not my hands or my teeth. Just as I began to wonder if the woman had been a figment of my imagination, her door swung open and she reappeared, a thick hemp rope clutched in her fist. I had to wonder what sort of person just happened to have a length of rope on hand. Then I thought of what might befall me if I stayed outside, nightfall, hypothermia, starvation, floating into oblivion. Standing in that doorway, she seemed somehow poised over a precipice at the edge of the world, like a superhero or a character in a children's book. Like maybe if she tipped out of the doorway, she would fly instead of fall. I'm going to throw this out to you, she shouted. She announced everything as she did it, like a friendly nurse. She tried to lasso the rope out of me, but it just flailed around the entryway and doorframe. The man appeared again, grabbed it from her without a word, and flung the rope out like a fishing line, which worked surprisingly well. It snaked towards me, and I caught it one-handed, and all three of us cheered as the rope bristled in my palm. And I guess I'll stop there.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Maria. I was curious about that story because it's kind of an anomaly a little bit in the rest of the book, because it's like maybe the one story that, correct me if I'm wrong, but like is kind of surreal in the collection. And I'm curious about how you approached that particular piece. We had a question last week about this idea of like genre fiction and the fantastical, and we're actually having in our reading series, Amy Bender's going to come in a few weeks. And this really reminded me a little bit of an Amy Bender kind of story where it's just an inexplicable surreal thing happens and then it goes away. And so I'm kind of curious about how you approached a story that has that kind of surreal element.
Yeah, it does sort of seem like an outlier in some ways because of the surreal element. I would say there's one other story that it's not surreal, but First Aid is, it's like kind of on the edge of what is actually occurring. And so I thought with two of them, that sort of made it something that had happens more than once. But I think it's so much about the character who has a lot of the same issues as all the other characters in the book that it worked. And you know, that just started with a premise that I thought was funny, and then of course the character became who she became in the course of putting her in that situation. And so I didn't even really think of it as, oh, now I'm going to write a surreal story. I just thought of the premise and just saw what would happen, and that's what happened.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it becomes a kind of metaphor, obviously, from the title alone, of what's happening in her life being turned upside down and kind of losing touch with herself. And I think it totally works when the surreal speaks to something thematic, I guess, or something within the character. Yeah. Becky, would you like to read something from your work?
Yeah. I loved that, Maria, by the way. It was so good.
Thanks.
That was a like scarily identifiable character. I am actually going to read from something that's not in either book. It's from a collection of stories that I'm working on sort of right now. Just to change things up a little bit. And I feel like it's definitely in conversation with the stories in Bad Kansas, and also probably with The Bright Side too. But yeah, it's called The Wilderness. I'd never been west of Kansas before, and neither had Corey, but the idea of getting a job in the mountains had gotten hold of his dick and wouldn't let go. He'd watched a movie about a rock climber who summited El Capitan with no rope. And it was this movie that had reached out and grabbed Corey's manhood with its hot, calloused, chalk-dusted palm and asked, "Motherfucker, are you even alive?" One day he was reading Vonnegut and falling into Reddit holes, and the next, all he could talk about was the wilderness. He wanted to detach from technology and connect with the wilderness. He wanted to test the limits of his body against the wilderness. He wanted to find out who he was when it was just him and the wilderness. "Can't you just sell your phone and work on your dad's farm?" I asked, but he looked at me like I'd proposed he dig a hole and live inside it. The job he applied for and accepted without my knowing was seasonal, May through September, maintaining trails in a national park called North Cascades. "It's in Washington," Corey explained, "only a couple hours from Seattle." He pronounced the name with a melody of awe, as another person might Xanadu or the Rings of Jupiter. I thought for a second. My mom had waited around for my dad for more than a decade, was still waiting for him, and even though he'd remarried and moved to Des Moines. I was willing to adjust my plans for Corey, but I was not yet willing to be left behind. "Either I go with you or we're breaking up," I said. "Of course," Corey said, his face flushed. "Of course you'll come with me." That night, I applied for a job at a gift store in the park's visitor center. The next week, I interviewed over the phone, and the week after, the job was mine. I would make minimum wage, but I would be near Corey, near the wilderness. It was a life I was willing to try on, at least for a summer. We weren't leaving behind much in Kansas. Corey had a job at a pretentious coffee shop known for brewing beans that had passed through the digestive system of a small Asian mammal called a civet, and I had a part-time job writing standardized test passages. We both wanted to be writers, him a poet, me an author of grand, sweeping novels set for unclear reasons in the Florida panhandle, meaning we had no true skills or money. What we had were jars of change we used to buy condoms and a cabinet full of shrimp ramen noodles. We stole one-ply toilet paper from our workplaces and shared a dim studio filled with black mold and brown recluses. These were the things we would miss: our small crew of friends, our green velvet love seat, and our hedgehog Christina, who we were leaving in the custody of Corey's little brother. Other than this, nothing mattered. We were in love, we had each other, we were going to experience the wilderness. The states went Colorado, Wyoming, Montana, Washington. Wyoming was my favorite: flat, open land, the sky Crayola blue. Meanwhile, Corey had mountains on the brain. With each town we passed, he'd comment on the elevation, a twinge of disappointment in his voice if we dropped even a few feet. I'd seen mountains once during a trip to Virginia when I was 13, so I thought I knew it was coming. But as we drove deeper west and the prairie lifted up towards the Rockies and then set us down on the other side, a terror descended. Everything came to a head in Washington. The mountains near the park were steep, the steepest in the lower 48, Corey said. They huddled around the highway like bullies with clenched fists. They had stolen the sky and had no intention of giving it back. I felt so claustrophobic, I wondered how I would survive the next 5 months. But then Corey slipped a hand between my thighs and squeezed three times, humming the chorus to Big Rock Candy Mountain. 2 days before, at a Goodwill in Casper, he'd purchased a blue flannel shirt, tattered Chaco sandals, and a tan Carhartt beanie. Adorably, he'd changed into them right away in a gas station bathroom, abandoning his sneakers and his oversized University of Kansas t-shirt. All these states later, I was still alarmed by how quickly he'd adopted this new version of himself, a version at once appealing and ridiculous. And I wondered what iterations of myself I might access with the ease of a dressing room. For so long, I'd been meek Kansas Andrea, with her jean shorts and secondhand Old Navy tank tops, a swoop of cheap brown eyeliner that flaked apart as the day went on. I made fun of girls who dressed wildly, accusing them of compensating for boring personalities. The truth was, I didn't have a lot of money and I was scared of drawing attention to myself. My mom had taught me that to want something, including the admiration of others, was to open yourself to disappointment and ultimately shame. Life was best lived as an armadillo, unassuming but secure. We were nearly to the park when we saw the sign, $2.75, the best burger in Washington State. The restaurant was called the Lonely Diner. It was small and sort of leaned to the side as if drunk, but the open sign glowed neon pink. We hadn't eaten since Idaho. Inside, the woman behind the counter shouted, "Sit down, babies, I'll be right with you." She was a big woman, so curvy and soft, she appeared boneless like a chicken nugget. She had a tight bun of wiry gray hair and wore a bald eagle emblazoned shirt that read, "Love our country, period." Amidst all this, her face was round and pretty. "We're not in Kansas anymore," Corey said. I looked at him like he was crazy. "Are we not?" I said. The whole place reeked of Kansas. Deer heads posted above a jukebox, a white-haired cowboy type vaping at the bar. Everything smelled of grease, and the menu offered 100 laminated pages of misspelled fried food offerings. Cheesy potato skins, bacon and tomato cheeseburger, everything served with real mayonnaise. I loved it. "Where are you two starry-eyed babies coming from?" said the chicken nugget, setting down two red Coca-Cola cups of tap water. "We're from Kansas," Corey said. Nugget's face exploded with glee. "Kansas, that's the nuttiest thing I've heard all day." She laughed for herself, waiting for us to laugh with her, which, being polite babies from Kansas, we did. "What brings you out here?" she asked. Corey explained about his job in the park, and Nugget nodded along. "I know half those crazy tree-hugging fools," she said. "You'll be in good hands. Where are you living?" "We're just camping for now," Corey said. Nugget turned to me. "Did you sign off on this arrangement, sweet pea?" "I don't mind camping," I said. In truth, I'd suggested we look for housing on Craigslist ahead of time, but Corey had nixed the idea. He wanted to get a lay of the land first, suss out the housing scene. These words, "lay of the land, suss out the scene," from the mouth of someone who had attended robotics camp for every summer of his youth. Nugget swiped the air with one of her wet-looking hands. "No, it's unacceptable. You two babies out in the trees in the rain, get in your car and follow me. I have a place." With this, she turned around, threw her towel on the bar, and exited through a back door. Corey and I exchanged looks. "Are we supposed to follow her?" he asked. "I think so," I said. Corey stood, put a clenched fist to his mouth to stifle a burp. We didn't even get a burger. We followed Nugget's rusted Ford Escort up the highway, then down a road called Memory Lane, then up a steep gravel drive, possibly to our deaths. By now, the trees had swallowed the sky, sun and all. I was imagining a soggy double wide with a cracked window and pull-out sofa stained spaghetti-o orange. A possum would be sitting at the kitchen table, reading the paper as his offspring ran amok, smearing feces into the carpet. "May I help you?" the possum would ask. Nugget parked in front of a two-story cabin with a wraparound porch and dormer windows. The wicker patio furniture was white, and a martini glass rested on the deck's railing. "Home sweet home," Nugget said, clambering out of her car. "The studio's above the garage." She toddled up a narrow staircase that ran along the detached garage. The landing was filled with potted flowers and glossy wooden sculptures of naked women, their misshapen breasts signaling something like, "Women actually have weird boobies, not the kind of jumbo porn stuff you see on the internet, for real." The thought in my head was, Nugget has killed the owners of this property and taken up residence. I watched as she removed a key from her pocket and led us into a studio so beautiful, I blinked to make certain it was real. Light poured in from the skylights as if a movie set design guy was dumping buckets of sunshine through the glass. In the living area, three tall windows read like a triptych of the green mountain beyond. The air smelled of cloves and incense. There were succulents and other tastefully potted flora arranged on the windowsills. Corey and I exchanged the same "what the fuck" look. Without warning, a crack of laughter escaped my lips. "What's the verdict?" Nugget asked. "It's really for rent?" I asked. Nugget began straightening magnets on the fridge. "My husband Rocky used to live here, but who knows where that son of a bitch went. His loss is your gain." "He's not coming back?" I asked. "Not if he wants to live," she said, and then gave a great big Santa Claus belly laugh. "If that porta potty shows his face around here, well, he won't. That's not something you have to worry about." "How much is rent?" I asked. She quit fiddling with the magnets and looked at me with absolute concentration, as if all her years of watching The Price is Right had been leading up to this moment. "300. "Per person?" I asked. "Total," she said. The light in the room grew a tick brighter. "We'll do it," I said, not bothering to consult Corey. For a moment, I'd forgotten he was there at all. I had never lived in a beautiful place before. I didn't realize it was something I wanted. I'll stop there.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Becky. That was great. We had a lot of compliments in the chat about certain lines that they liked that were pretty funny. And both you guys use humor quite a bit in your writing, actually. We'll move to maybe some of the Q&A. And I think this kind of, there's a couple of questions that were arising while you guys were reading. And one was earlier, thinking about genre, thinking about novels versus short stories, and how do you know? It says sometimes when I think I have an idea, I abandon it, and I never know if I should write a novel or a short story. And then in the Q&A, there was somebody who had a similar question, thinking about wanting to write an autobiographical piece, but not sharing if they should do it through a series of essays or a memoir. And I guess we're thinking short form versus long form. And I guess it comes back to this idea of, like, how do you know you have a novel on your hands? And how do you know it's like, this is not, does not have legs to write a short story? What do you guys think? Maria, do you want to start us off?
Yeah. I think I usually know when it's going to be a short story. Like, the idea is contained. Like, for example, I wanted to write about the woman floating away from the earth, and I just knew that it was a conceit that was kind of contained in a small period. Although there's been times where a short story got a little out of control, like the last story in my book is kind of novella length. And that's a time where you could say, well, it could just keep going and make this bigger, and it could be a novel. But otherwise, I feel like there's a different texture to a short story. So to me, it's almost like, will it be a poem or a story? I would know. And in the same way, I think, will it be a story or a novel? And I can usually just tell the difference. I guess that may not help.
No, I like the idea of containment, right? Where it's like, okay, there's only so much I could contain here in like 20 pages, and I can't talk about it for 300, right? Becky, what do you think?
I feel like I also just sort of intuitively know when something's going to be a story, because it's like, there's just one situation I want to explore. It's like, okay, the situation of these two characters leaving Kansas, going to this new place that they've never been before. Like, that feels like something I can contain. But where the novel comes in is there's maybe like an originating situation, but then I don't know where it's gonna take the characters, and I'm not ready to leave them yet. So it's like more about the characters and what kind of growth they could have over maybe a longer period of time, rather than just characters contained within one situation that's already relatively mapped out in my head, even if I don't know where the story's gonna end when I start.
Right, and I kind of like a follow-up to that question. Your novel has multiple points of view, and so, you know, that it's harder to contain in a short story. But I'm also curious, you're talking about like, what potential does a character have to grow? But you're dealing with multiple characters in that novel, and they all have to have their arc and growth. And so I'm kind of curious about how you juggle omniscience, even if it's in a short story, but also in a larger work. How do you approach that kind of point of view?
Yeah, Brightside was really fun to write because of the multiple points of view. There's three points of view in the book, and there's the arguably the main character, Ariel, who is returning to her mom's animal sanctuary after sort of abandoning it 6 years before. And then there's the point of view of her mom, who owns the sanctuary and feels abandoned by Ariel. And then maybe my favorite point of view to write was Ariel's fiance in the book, who it doesn't know anything about Ariel's history or the animal sanctuary. And so the way point of view worked in the Brightside and what made it fun was that the reader's discovering all of this information along with Ariel's fiance, who's been in the dark. So you sort of see these two characters colliding, and you're only getting one of their perspectives in each chapter. So you sort of see the situation zoomed out as the reader, but then you get to dip in and see what it looks like from each individual's point of view. And that, I mean, that's fun to write as the writer, but it also, I think, in terms of just thinking about literature and what it's trying to do, that's our whole world all the time, is just, we're all in this situation together and everything looks different depending on where you're looking at it from. So I think it helps exercise some of those muscles in the writer's brain too, of like, oh, you know, you might think one character's the good guy, but then from this angle, their behavior is kind of questionable, and it's fun to rotate around a situation like that.
Yeah, the mother-daughter storyline, I mean, that kind of like feels natural. Did the fiance's point of view come in kind of like as an, like not an afterthought, but like come in later, like, oh, I need like a third objective point of the triangle or something to come in? Or did you plan on writing it from his point of view from the beginning? Because he's kind of like an outlier in the story that adds a new dimension to it.
Well, originally, I think this is, you know, it has to do with the book's evolution. Because when I first wrote it back as an undergrad, it was just a love story, mostly between Ariel and her fiance, Dex. So it was just their two point of views. And then I added the mom later on, because clearly it was always a mother-daughter story and I just hadn't figured that out. But I like, as you said, that Dex's fiance is sort of an objective outside view onto this really complicated, intimate relationship between a mom and a daughter. And like, he has no skin in that particular game. So we sort of see it from his point of view as the reader. But
very cool. Well, this also goes along to with style. Another question in the Q&A was, it's a long one because they're referencing both a couple stories that they've read from you guys. So Maria, they read Elegy, which is up on our website if you want to read it on your own, thinking about a second person story told backwards. As you admit, it's an homage to Laurie Moore's famous piece. And then Becky, they read Goodbye Sugarland, which is also up on our website, and how they noticed that there isn't like a classic climax and that's kind of a quieter ending. I guess what they're getting to is kind of experimentation. And how did you know you were ready to start breaking some of the classic rules, make those bold choices? And did you have mentors who encouraged you so, or was it your decision? So did you have to have permission to experiment, or and how do you approach it, that kind of breaking of the rules? Maria, would you like to start us off, since you write maybe more classically experimental stuff, if there is such a thing?
I really was encouraged to write very straightforward narratives. So it was sort of my own making that I started doing some of the more experimental stuff. And some of it, I think, is due to my impatience with transitions or like writing the whole story. So you can just sort of skip over a lot of stuff when you make it choppy or you're playing with form like that. And sometimes you can be a little more poetic. But it's interesting because the two stories in my book that are in the second person, which is Elegy and How to Wait, that are, you know, a lot like the Laurie Moore stories in self-help, I those stories just sort of came out in that form. Those are stories are, they're neither of them are about me, but they're related to things very close to home, and they were emotional. I wrote the story about the husband getting deployed right when my brother was deployed, and so it hit me, and it was, I had read Laurie Moore's story so many times, and it was sort of just like a container to put it in. And it was just sort of there, like waiting for me as a structure. So I thought it was interesting that both those stories were sort of just came out that way. And it was really less of a choice and something that I kind of ran with and used at that time.
Absolutely. And so the question I was also asking Becky about, like, maybe quieter endings or kind of breaking the narrative structure rules. But how do you know when you need to start breaking some of the textbook rules that you might learn in the classroom?
I feel like I am like a rule stickler in my fiction. And I'm not good at experimenting all the time, and I love transitions and the structure and the, like, I feel like I'm maybe the opposite of some of what Maria was talking about. And it's funny because in Goodbye Sugarland, that story is an opening chapter to a novel that I have written most of. So I think that's why there's a quieter ending, is because it's a chapter end and not an actual, like, in my mind, I didn't start it or write it as a short story. But I do think that there is room for experimentation in my career down the road. And I'm excited to explore it at some point. And I like doing some, like, the novel I'm working on now is a ghost story. And that's been unusual for me. I don't really enter other genres that often. And I found it to be really fun because, like, magical things can happen on the page, and yet it still feels like character-based fiction, which is what my primary concern is with character. So it's been fun playing around with how genre can push against characters and not necessarily, you know, take over the whole story.
I like that idea of pushing against characters. And really, like you were saying, Maria, like your experimental stuff is, you know, it's more fragmented, but it opens up lyricism, but I think it opens up humor too. And both you guys' stories that you even read today were infused with a lot of, you know, cynicism or sarcasm or some wittiness that I think that we forget that happens in writing. In fact, many of my students read Goodbye Sugarland and they were very touched and laughing at the main character's, you know, conflict. Last question, it looks like, and this is like a broad one, but this might be a good way to kind of end in terms of philosophy. We have an anonymous question to ask, why did you start writing? And maybe we can add on to that as saying, like, how did you know you wanted to be a writer? Or what motivated you to go down this road? Many of our students are always like, how do I get started in writing? Can I be a writer? Do I have permission to be a writer or an English major? And so maybe this would help thinking about how you guys approached it when you started out. Becky, do you want to start us off?
Sure. Yeah, that's a really good question, and one I asked all the time throughout my writing education. I think that everyone's always waiting for someone to tell them that it's okay or to give them that permission. And unfortunately, that permission doesn't exist anywhere but inside your own brain. So go ahead and give it to yourself if you love writing. I had a lot of support and encouragement from English teachers along the way. So I think that that gave me some of the confidence I needed to keep going. But I also just love writing, and I've always loved writing. And I think all the time about whether I could quit and be happy. And I think I would just, you know, like if I quit and tried to be a lawyer, I would just want to write about being a lawyer. Or if I quit and tried to be a nurse, I would just want to write about being a nurse. So I think you know that you need to do it when you can't see a way out of it. And I remember when I was an undergrad, I got to interview the poet Nikki Finney. And I asked, I was like so eager at that age for established writers to give me something I could like hold on to and take with me. And I asked her that same question, like, how do you know if you should do this? And she was like, this is not an easy life. It's very hard. And you know, you have to ask yourself, if you can do anything else and be happy, you should do that instead. And so that sort of resonated with me. And so far, I don't think I could do anything else and be happy. But she's right that it's not an easy life. But I think it's a meaningful one. So that's what I hold on to.
Oh, absolutely. Maria, did you have some thoughts on that big question?
Yeah, I mean, it's funny that you say that, because there is that one Laurie Moore story, How to Be a Writer, I think it's called. And she says, you know, if you can do anything else, do it. And for a long time, that kind of gnawed at me, because I was like, I think I could do some other things. Like, oh, if that's not the only thing I could do, should I not be a writer? And I think for me, it's not necessarily about the writing specifically, but a craving to live a creative life in some way. It wouldn't necessarily have to be writing fiction. It could be in the arts. It's just that I sort of focused on writing fiction. And so that's where I ended up. But I didn't do great at a 9 to 5. And I thought, oh, I'll write at night. And it really wasn't happening. And that's how I ended up applying to an MFA program, is just I needed the time to write, and I needed the time to figure out if I could do it in some way. And yeah, it's not easy. I think you often have to do a lot of other things as well as be a writer, if you're a writer. But yeah, I guess I just wanted it enough that I took that chance to quit a job and go in this other direction.
Awesome. All right. Thanks so much for your insight, guys. Many of you didn't know this, obviously, but Maria is speaking to us actually from Denmark, because she got locked down in Copenhagen over the last year. And so that's where she's joining from. And I really appreciate you taking the time to do so. And same thing with Becky. I had one last question for you. There's somebody in our class who's like, I wonder how many times she uses the line, we're not in Kansas anymore, or she's obligated to do that in every single story. And then you wrote a story that used that line, and I was curious about, does that line plague you?
You know, it plagues me in real life. Like when I worked at a gift store in Grand Teton National Park, and my name tag said my name, and everyone had to say where they're coming from. So mine said like, Becky from Kansas.
Oh no.
And it was like once a day, twice a day, some old man would be like, you're not in Kansas anymore, are you? Like, oh, I wish that I had like kept a log and been like, would you like to sign your name? Number 47, who said that to me. But I appreciate the Wizard of Oz for all it's done for Kansas.
Absolutely. I think you use it as like use a quote from it at the beginning of your book, which yeah. I really appreciated.
Yeah, it's a lovely story when you think about it.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much, guys, for joining us and offering your input. And thank you, everybody, for attending the reading and having such great questions. Join us next week for two poets who will be coming and visiting us next Wednesday. But in the meantime, you should check out your local bookstore, by Girls of a Certain Age by Maria Edelman, and of course the novel The Bright Side Sanctuary for Animals by Becky Mandelbaum. And thank you guys again for your insight.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, everybody. Thank you for coming.
Bye, everyone.
Thank you. Let's see here. I'm always confused about how to get out of here because I think it just last week I just clicked a button and everybody just went away and I was like, okay, I guess we'll say bye guys. I felt horrible about it, but anyway, thanks for coming guys, and I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. This was great.
Absolutely. All right. We'll keep in touch, and I'll be sending stuff probably soon enough about the contracts and stuff. So
okay. Great.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.